For NASA astronauts Suni Williams and Butch Wilmore, the long wait to return to Earth is almost over. They went up to the International Space Station last June in a Boeing Starliner spacecraft and were supposed to return about a week later. But because of problems with the Starliner, they've stayed at the space station for over 250 days and are now set to return on a SpaceX capsule next month. I spoke with them, along with their crewmate, Nick Hague, earlier today. Commander Williams, Captain Wilmore, and Colonel Hague, welcome to the News Hour. Thank you so much for joining us.
It's just absolutely our pleasure to be here on the PBS News Hour with you. It's great to be able to talk about space, and because I know a lot of people are interested. So thank you for taking the time.
We're so grateful for your time. Commander Williams, when you first went up last June, let's remind folks here, you were only supposed to be up there about a week or so. You've now been up in space about 250 days. You've probably heard in the conversation back here on Earth some people saying you are stuck up there, other people saying that you were abandoned up there. I'm just curious for your take. How do you look at it? Do you feel stuck or abandoned?
You know, I wouldn't characterize it like that. I think, you know, obviously there's a lot of discussion about it, so maybe people could conceive that that's the way we are, but we're not stuck. We're part of a bigger process, right? We're part of an International Space Station crew, and we just happened to be the second part, the second two on the crew that was that came up here. Nick came up here with one other gentleman, and it's usually four of us up here for a increment. And so Butch and I extended to go along with that increment per the plan, because you know, those spacecraft rotate every 6 months or so. So, you know, nothing is really for, as Butch put it before, it's not about Butch and I, it's about, you know, our obligation to our international partners and, you know, fulfilling the world-class science that we're doing up here on the International Space Station.
And I want to ask more about that work and Colonel Hague's role in all this too, but Captain Wilmore, I have to ask, it may seem trivial, but presumably you would pack differently for 7 days than you would for 10 months. I mean, do you have and have you had what you need up there in the way of clothes and toiletries and so on?
We did launch with fewer clothing, if you will, and that was intentional. We brought up some extra gear that needed the space station needed. We brought it up with us, so we took some of our clothes off. We were only going to be here a week or so, but we made do. It was no big deal, honestly. The space station program plans for multiple contingencies. We stockpile food to last 4 months beyond what is expected at a minimum. Most times it's longer than that. Food and other amenities, you know, wet wipes, everything that you need up here. It takes a lot for human spaceflight, for humans to live in space since the year 2000. So we've been at it 25 years almost now, and that is just a normal part of the process.
So Colonel Hague, tell us about your role here. You arrived at the space station in September. Was part of your mission to bring some of those additional supplies for Commander Williams and Captain Wilmore? And tell us a little bit about the work that you've been doing aboard the space station as well.
Yeah, when we arrived in late September, we did bring up some essential supplies that we needed immediately. But we've had cargo vehicle, you know, one cargo vehicle show up in between. And so what have we been up to? I got to tell you, you know, for life on board the space station, we're having a lot of fun. We're laughing every day, and we're doing some really serious scientific research. We're working on material science research. We're working on, you know, biological research. We're growing plants. We're trying to figure out how to prevent and treat diseases on the ground. And we're also trying to figure out how to grow food so we can go to Mars someday.
Commander Williams, we should also mention, over the course of this trip, you have now broken the record for total spacewalking time by a woman astronaut. It's now a total of 62 hours and 6 minutes outside the ship in space. I have to ask, did you know that you broke that record when it happened? And what was that moment like?
Not really. You know, when you're on a spacewalk, you're pretty intense on what's going on outside. You know, that's pretty much forefront on your mind. You know, I knew that I had a lot of spacewalks as I came into this mission. I didn't really know the hours or really pay attention to it that much. It's sort of just happenstance and time and place. But, you know, I know Peggy Whitson really well. I respect her a whole lot. And, you know, to actually surpass her in anything is just amazing. So that's a pretty awesome honor to have that.
Captain Wilmore, I once asked an astronaut to describe for me, as best as he could, what it felt like to leave the space station, to exit that hatch, which I understand points straight down, so you see nothing but space when you basically flip and head out of the space station into space, what that moment feels like. And he described it as horrifying, but also the biggest thrill that you could ever imagine. What is that like for you? Can you describe that?
I can't. No, there's no way to put it into words adequately. It's thrilling. It's amazing. And one of the things that makes it special is that during that time you're outside, there's nobody else in the entire universe doing what you're doing. And that's a unique experience in and of itself. And of course, the view is unbelievable. It's 180 degrees. It's a helmet, you know, a visor around the side. It's 180 degree view. And it is mesmerizing. There's a couple of adjectives for you, but that doesn't do it justice.
Well, Colonel Hague, I'm going to assume that keeping a pretty regular routine is key to life up in the space station. So just walk us through it. What does a typical day look like? Does every day kind of start the same way for you?
Yeah, you know, a typical day, the day starts early. You know, I'll get up at 6 a.m. And it's a chance to eat breakfast and have some coffee and check some email. But then the work day starts at 7:30 in the morning, and then it goes until 7:30 in the evening. What we do on any given day just depends on what the team on the ground has planned and worked out that we're going to be able to do. Science, maintenance, a big chunk of that is taking care of ourselves to make sure that we don't suffer the negative effects of living in weightlessness. And so we spend 2.5 hours a day, every day, working out, lifting weights, exercising cardiovascular system. yes, Sunny's been bulking up for the return trip so she can withstand gravity when we get down to the ground.
You've mentioned you are able to occasionally speak with your families back home, who I know are making such a big sacrifice with all of you up there, especially for as long as you've been there. I just wonder, Colonel Hague, kick us off here. I know you have two sons back home. When's the last time you talked to them? What do you talk about when you get that chance?
Yeah, I spoke to him over the weekend. We've got pretty regular contact. And what do we talk about? We talk about all the normal things that a dad talks to his sons about. Basketball practice and what he's working on. How is school going? I've got a son that's getting ready to head off to college next year. Where are you going to go? And have you heard back from the places you've applied? All the normal things that you would talk about.
Yeah, I talk to my oldest daughter about things that interest her. She's in the theater program at a university in Texas, and those things are interesting to her, and therefore it's very interesting to me. And my youngest daughter, it's a full gamut. You know, I talked to her about many things. She has a boyfriend. I talk to her boyfriend. I'm very, very direct with him as well. So, yeah, it's all important.
Wait, you talk to your daughter's boyfriend from space? That has to be the most intimidating thing for a boyfriend.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, that's my role. As a dad to daughters, that's my responsibility.
I just have to say, I mean, obviously the contributions that you all are making through this work they're absolutely immeasurable. Back here at home, what's the message you want people to take away from this chance that they're getting to hear directly from you while you're there in space?
I'll make it quick. Your human spaceflight program is here for you. That's what my message would be to all the folks back there. We work, we train, we prepare. We are committed to what our responsibilities are, what our national goals are, what our international partners and all, and we work together for that. And we are here to work for y'all.
And I'll add, don't be afraid of change. You know, we've experienced it, and we all will live through it. We'll all be fine. And, you know, every change is a new opportunity, and take those opportunities.
I'll throw one last thing there. When we float over the window, and we spend a lot of time in the window looking down at the Earth, for me, the Earth starts to look pretty small when you look at the backdrop of you know, the rest of the universe behind it, and we're all on it together. And so just like the human spaceflight program relies on everybody working together across the globe to make this magic happen up here, we rely on each other on the ground every day. Everyone out there depends on other people. You know, we're all on Earth together.
Colonel Nick Hague, Commander Sunny Williams, and Captain Butch Wilmore, thank you so very much for taking the time to speak with us, for the work that you do. We're very, very grateful. Please travel safe.
Thank you very much. See you back on Earth.
An absolute treat and such an honor to speak with those astronauts. Thank you again.